We come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord. We thank you, Father, that we haven't come to hear from a man or come to hear from a woman. We have come to hear from the teacher of the church. It's not a human. They're only communicating your word. It's the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. We just love you. We're grateful that you're here. We honor your presence. We just tell you that we're just in love with you, love with Jesus, love with the Father. Come and be our teacher tonight, like the Word of God says. Cause the Word of God to become alive and sharp on the inside of us, and that we could use it all the days of our life to understand who God is and who we are and what the plan of the Lord has for us. And we'll give you the praise, give you the glory, all the honor. We thank you, Father, as we go before you tonight, that we can lift up all the churches in the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless them, Father, and God will give you the praise, give you the glory. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody say amen. Go ahead, take your seat. Get your Bible out. Turn it anywhere you want to go and just start reading. And in 30 minutes from now, we'll dismiss you. Wouldn't that be horrible? No, it's not that way at all. This is a message called The Importance of, if you will, Capacity. Capacity is an amazing thing. I never realized how important it is until just recently. Last few weeks, Debbie and I had gotten away, and we went on a little vacation together. And she asked me what I thought of the vacation. I said, well, I didn't see much. I kept thinking all the time. I keep seeing buildings and cities and bridges, and keep seeing boats, giant, big steel boats, oil liners and freighters, and I keep seeing even tugboats and high rises and condos, and I'm just bewildered by it all. She said, what do you think? I said, I have no idea. I've just stopped looking at stuff. We were in a place where there were condos that just went to the sky overlooking the ocean, and you know, we were just there. I mean, you can look at the ocean, see how beautiful it was. I was staring at all the buildings. I just couldn't get away from the buildings. And what was baffling on the inside of me and what was bouncing around on the inside of me was, who in the heck builds these things? Who owns them? They don't go to our church. Who wants to build them? Who has a stamina to build them? What kind of people do this? What's it take? I mean, we people that are Christians talk about how God's going to bless us, and I believe God blesses us eternally and spiritually. And there's no ifs, ands, or buts about that. That's the greatest reward, greatest wealth there'll ever be. But, you know, how about a little bit of wealth? We live in San Bernardino, and there's not high rises at all. And anything that's over four stories high, you might get mugged on the fifth story. Who knows, you know? And it's a crazy place. And yet I was at a place where there was so much abundance of material things that were built, and the question kept popping up, who owns them? And why do they own them? And what made them get into that oil business? Or what made them start building gasoline tankers? And what made them start to build trucking companies? And what made them build shipping companies? And what made them are people that have these high-rise, who builds high-rise condominiums? You know, Deborah and I build a little house here and there, but who builds these high-rise condominiums? We think we're all that because we got a little construction job going on once in a while. I mean, who builds these things? It's unbelievable. What kind of faith is it that takes to do something like that? I was just stunned by it. And Deb and I were talking a few days back, and we were sitting there having coffee in the morning, and we were talking about the things of the Lord. And she said this word, capacity. And when she said the word, it was like somebody ran up and hit a bell. Bang! You remember that, Mama? And I just absolutely couldn't get away from the word capacity. The rest of the day, I was absorbed by this word capacity. And I got to tell you something. I didn't know where it was taking me. I didn't know what it meant. I didn't understand anything. I just knew this word was a key word for everything I'd gone through for the last couple of weeks. And everything that I'm going to go through for the rest of my life is hinging on a word called capacity. And I realized that a lot of people in American churches have faith, and that's great. And we need to have faith. Don't think for a moment that I'm belittling the greatness of faith. But faith without capacity only takes you so far. And a lot of times we just don't see that. Let me explain and put up on the overhead what capacity means simply from the Webster's Dictionary. It means the ability to contain. Space that holds, contains content or value. The ability to contain. So if I have faith but don't have the ability to contain what it is I'm believing God for, does everybody know where I'm going on this? Then all of a sudden my faith is hindered. Or if I have faith and my, if you will, my capacity is limited and I don't know how to handle what it is I'm believing God for, then my capacity level is so low, God can't bless me. And I see that people who even didn't have any faith in God are starting these amazing businesses and have these high rises and have, I'm talking about billion-dollar wealth, billion-dollar companies right before my very eyes all day long without God. And it's like so frustrated. I've got God, and I'm saying, God, I don't understand this. And a lot of it has to do with your ability or your capacity level, your ability to contain something, hold it in place, see it beyond yourself, you know, and if the world can build what they build and, you know, design what they design and equip what they equip and function in these markets that are exorbitant out there, can I just ask you a question? What in the world, if they can do that without God, how much more should the church be doing? All we need to do is we've got faith, but we don't have capacity. And I really believe, and I'll prove it to you, and I'll show it to you by the scripture right now. Listen to me. There's an attack against your capacity constantly that keeps you small-minded and keeps you small-thinking and keeps you worried and frustrated and discouraged and keeps you from stepping out and believing God. Like somebody in the world will step out and think nothing of building and be thrilled about building a billion-dollar building. Our organization, and we fall apart over a few thousand dollars because our capacity level is lousy. Our faith in God is great, but our capacity level stinks. And I mean, why is it that some pastors have great big churches, some pastors have little churches? Some of the pastors I've seen over the years that have little churches are better preachers than those that have big churches. Same faith, same God. Got to be something going on here that I'm not aware of. And we can all blame and say, well, I guess it's God. Well, it might be, and it surely is. But at the same time, could it be that there's a different capacity level? What some people think is okay, another person sees as small. One person says is great. I'm happy. I'm thrilled. I've reached my mental desires and my dream, and yet another person looks at that dream and says, oh my God, you haven't done anything. You just got past where your mother and father were, and you feel good about that. You did better than your mom and dad, so therefore you feel good about that, and you stop because your capacity, you still go to church, still want all the abundant stuff, but you never go past your mom and dad. And the influence of capacity has a lot to do with your parenting. Did you know that? I never knew that. For an example, let me show you something. I'm going to make a statement to you. Kind of an interesting statement. I really believe many times, not all times, that God chooses people in the Bible. Watch me, listen to me. Let me say it again. I really believe many times, not all times, that God chooses people in the Bible who do great things because they have two functions going on. One is faith in God. The other is a capacity for a future that is designed like God. Let me give you an illustration. If somebody is going somewhere that they think is wonderful, but it's really nowhere at all, you're going to, if you follow them, only go to where they go. But if somebody has something out there that's wow, and they're going to that place and you're following them, guess where you're going? So who you follow has a lot to do with the ability that you're going to attain and call capacity. Really fascinating. Now, I made a statement, and you just might as well hear it again, that God selects people who have faith and capacity to have a future that brings people into God's plan. If God had a plan for you and you were following me, but I was taking you to a different place because my capacity level was way down here, and I could only go there. In other words, I'm satisfied with just doing where I'm doing. I'm only happy down here. I never will go any further. This is all I'm ever going to be. You and following me, guess what? You're only going to go to where I go. But if I have a capacity level that is hinged on who he is, his ability, now listen to this, his ability, not my ability, then there's unlimited future ahead of us. And that's the point of all of this. Is oftentimes, where you're at is where you really want to be instead of where God wants you to be. Sorry I said that because that'll hurt your heart. But we're going to come in here and learn, grow. And you may not like this, and it may taste bad and like spinach to Popeye. It'll make you strong. A lot of times, your, if you will, capacity is based on what you learned from your mother, your father, school teachers, the sergeant in the army, maybe the family that you live in and come from. Instead of the capacity that you should be looking at, designed by God. Without limits. And what if I, as I said earlier, could show you how God selects oftentimes, not always, men and women of God in the Bible who had a different capacity level than the norm of society. For an example, let's take Saul in 1 Samuel, the 9th chapter. He's the first king of Israel. Now, we all know that Saul failed, but did you know that Saul was a pretty good guy before he got a hold of some stuff and his capacity level wasn't enough to handle all of the prestige and power and wealth, recognition, approval, and acceptance of people. So he fell apart at the end, probably ended up in hell, I'm sure. But he was the first king of Israel before David, right? So let's just talk about it for a moment. Now, God could have selected anybody that he wanted for the children of Israel, but he loves the children of Israel and wants to take them into the promised land. Promised land is a great place. Promised land is filled with milk and honey. Promised land is filled with wealth. God wants to bless his people. We don't ever see that. We don't think about that, but God really underlined, wrote that big Bible because God wants you to know how to do life so that you can get blessed in every area of your life, home, family, children, finances, dream, vision, destiny, purpose, job, everything. Everything is blessed because then you become this witness to God, to a lost and dying world. They want to know what you have. Right now, the church is looked at by the world as a bunch of losers. That's sad. And here's 1 Samuel. Put up verse number 1. And it makes a statement about Samuel. In 1 Samuel, it makes a statement about Saul. It says, there was a man, 1 Samuel, the 9th chapter, verse number 1, there was a man in Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Ebal, the son of Zerah, the son of whatever, a Benjamite. And then these words, five words, a mighty man of power. I don't know if you ever noticed that. What the heck does that mean? What the heck does that mean? A mighty man of power. Well, let's go on to verse number 2. Before I explain it to you. And he says, and he had a choice, handsome son whose name was Saul. Here's a guy being selected to be the king over Israel. And his family, go back to verse number 1, talking about his father, is a mighty man of power. Do you know what that means? He's Bill Gates of his time. He's wealthy. He's powerful. He's got material things. He's got great houses. He's great stuff. And all of a sudden, now listen to this. You got to see this. The capacity level of Saul was now, if you will, and it's a wonderful understanding, capacity level of Saul was established by his family's finances. Now, wait a minute. And because he now is not ready to settle for a little thing, but can believe God for great things, God will bring him into it so he can lead the people to great things and never stay at a little thing. Is anybody following me so far? Not only do we see that in the life of Saul, how his, if you will, capacity level was established by the greatness of his father and the wealth of his family. We see that also in a servant by the name of Elisha. There's Elijah, who was the first prophet of God. He wasn't really, he did great things. But there was one that followed after him, had double the great things. His name was Elisha. And really fascinating what happens to Elisha, if I may show you, in the 19th chapter of 1 Samuel. Go there, and let's just pop it up, verse 19. And he departed from there. And Elijah is now going after Elisha. So Elisha, the younger prophet, will follow Elijah. So he's being selected to take the place of Elijah, okay? So he departed from there and he found Elisha, the son of Zarephath. The son of Zarephath, if you circle it in your Bible, is an incredibly rich man who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen before him, and he was with the 12th. This guy owned 12 yoke of oxen. Now, you say that doesn't mean anything to you, because you guys, you drive your automobiles, you live in your houses, you don't know anything about this. But 12 yoke of oxen in those days, he was the Bill Gates of his day. If you had a plow and you pulled it, if your wife pulled the plow or she ran the plow and you pulled it in front with human power, you were a rich man. Did you know that? You were a rich man if your wife was behind the plow and you had it over your shoulders as a harness and you pulled it yourself. If you had a donkey pulling your plow, you were really rich. And nobody had an oxen pulling their plows. He's got 12 of them. And he's with the 12th pair. So that is unbelievable. Now, I want to just share this with you. His, if you will, capacity level was established by the way his lifestyle was as a child. No, you got to get this. He knew what wealth was all about. He knew what goodness was all about. He knew what right kind of living is all about. He knew what wealth and riches could purchase. And his capacity level now is determined. So God comes along and says, this guy, Elisha's got a lot of faith. And he's got a lot of capacity towards good things. And I want my people to go to good things. I can't have somebody lead my people to good things when they don't know what good things are. Now, this is kind of cool, but if you read that, it's just an amazing understanding. Their earthly fathers established their capacity. Oftentimes, your family established your capacity. Your earthly father or parent established your capacity. That's why I could sit back and stare. Who does that stuff? Who builds that business? Who runs that multi-million dollar shipping company? Their capacity level was completely different than our capacity level. Now, may I say this to you? For those of you who think I'm just talking off my hat, let me just go through the Bible just a little bit more. Abraham, father of faith, did not come out of a broken down, defeated family. Very wealthy. In the land of Ur, his father was incredibly wealthy. In fact, that was the shock of Abraham. He gave all that up to follow God. That was amazing. Then you stop and you think about, here's Moses. Why did God select somebody from the house of Egypt, in the palaces of Egypt, from the food of Egypt, from the wines of Egypt, from the wealth of Egypt, to lead his people into the promised land? Couldn't take a slave because his capacity level was established by his father and his mother. Couldn't take his slave to take the people into the promised land, because a slave just wanted to park by the river and say, leave me alone. But somebody had to drive them and push them into the promised land and have some kind of capacity level that was beyond the norm of mankind. Let's go to the New Testament. About Paul. If you read the life of Paul and his education and his father and his mother background, wealthy, my friends, when he was taught by the greatest teachers the world had ever known in those days, that isn't cheap. Then all of a sudden, God can use Paul, because now his capacity level was established by, and he wasn't gonna settle for a little house on one side of the track. He was going to go do something great. And that's the difference oftentimes with people, is that we stop at our own capacity level. How about Peter? Something a lot of people don't know about Peter. Peter is very wealthy. Very wealthy fisherman. In fact, when Debbie and I were in Israel, Peter actually, his wife was the one who had money, but they had wealth, and they would build these big giant, if you will, like swimming pools. When they catch their fish right on the Sea of Galilee, they would bring their fish, put them in these big giant swimming pools and keep them alive. So you could go to Peter's business and buy live fish from the Sea of Galilee, not dead, dried up fish. Very wealthy. Why? Because his capacity level was established by his parents. So here's where you rubs you wrong. Here's where you don't take it any further than that. You hear me saying that if you're not rich, you can never have a better and bigger capacity level. And I'm not saying that, so get off of it. Because there's one that comes along, his name is Jesus, and he's born in a manger. Why? In a manger, just to disprove that you have to come from a wealthy family in order to have a large capacity level. Now listen to what I'm going to say to you. Jesus comes and his capacity level is determined and made and evaluated and equipped. His ability to contain and to see the future and the greatness of the future came from his Father, which is what we don't do, is we don't allow the Father to change the capacity level of what our earthly parents gave to us. And so when I saw all these buildings, they're out there as a monument. They're not out there as a monument just to, for business and people. They're out there to say to the church, wake up. Wake up. If they can do it without God because they have a what? A, if you will, they have a different container of what they're holding, then we need to change our container as to what the Father says and what He believes and what His ability is instead of our own ability. Until this gets down on the inside of you, you'll stay with the earthly, if you will, capacities that you've been given. And so many times we have earthly capacities. Now, I don't know if the camera can get in on this or not, but let's just say this is you. God established you, and you have a capacity. And God comes along, and He puts a little of you in. Starts to fill you up. Can you get that on the overhead at all? Can you go down and get that? That's good. I mean, you fill that up. And then, you know, you go to church, you get a little bit more, and you get filled with the Holy Ghost, you get a little bit more. And this is your capacity level. If I kept pouring this, the water would come over the edge and just run all over the place. Because that's capacity level, see? So what happens is we go live according to the world and our whole capacity level changes. All of a sudden we're getting filled up with the world and all of a sudden we have problems. Same capacity level, it's just got junk in it now. It's just got frustration, sickness, disease, disappointments, lack of understanding, pollution of one kind or another. Go home, listen to the news, the world's falling apart, you're never going to do anything, so why try to do something? Then you go home and you sit about business and you start thinking about taxes, why do it? Man, the government's going to take it all, so I just won't do anything. So before you know it, your capacity level is filled, but it's filled with junk. And that's why people don't go any further than where they're at. Now, let me just give you an illustration of something that you need to know. Are you listening to me so far? I want to share with you some truths because Jesus said it like this in a parable, Matthew 25th chapter. I'm only going to read four verses in Matthew 25th chapter. I gave them a bunch of verses back there. I hope they didn't have to put them all up. I meant to just give you four. I actually reduced it down, but it still says there. So Matthew 25, here's what Jesus said about that. Matthew 25, verse number 14 says this. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling in a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. You followed me so far. This is Jesus talk, red letter. Verse 14, 25th chapter. So here it is. The kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling in a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another he gave 2, and to the another 1. To each according to his own capacity, ability to deal with it. And immediately he went out on a journey. Verse number 16 says this. Then he who received 5 talents went out and traded them, and he made another 5 talents. Wow, pretty aggressive. Here's a guy that had capacity to do this. The interesting part is verse, if you will, number 17. And likewise, you see the word likewise there? And likewise, he who received 2 gained 2 more. You know what the word likewise means? It means copying. In other words, he went out, saw the guy made 5, and he copied him and did the same thing and made 2. Why? Because all of a sudden, somebody was before him that showed him how to expand his capacity level. And he followed him. Now, if the guy with 2 saw the guy with 5, then the guy with 1 must have seen it too. But he decided to stay, listen to this, if you will, in verse number 18. And say, he who received 1 went out and dug in the ground, and he hid his Lord's money. In other words, he stayed where he was at his capacity level, with just 1, afraid to lose the 1. I don't know about you, but fear stops a lot of us from doing a lot of things. I want to give you one quick little understanding about capacity that'll help us tonight. Then I'll give you a couple more things and we'll conclude. Thinking, or I should have put the word wrong there. Wrong thinking can stop capacity. Let me say it again. Wrong thinking, what's under attack is probably not your faith. It's probably your capacity to continue your faith. Let me say it again. What's under attack is probably not your faith, but your capacity to continue in your faith. When things don't happen the way you want them to happen and you start to think something different, I don't understand. I don't understand a lot of things either, but that's not stopping me from doing what God called me to do. And I don't need anybody to do it but God. Somebody ought to say amen about that. Now here's the deal. I had an employee, he was an interesting character, worked for us at the old church. And whatever you gave him, I mean, we really loved this person. He was a neat guy. Whatever you gave him to do, if you gave him 10 things to do during the day, he would do 8 of them. I don't know why, just did 8. If you gave him 8, you figure, well, I'll just make life good for him because we love him. You know, we're a church, want to help him, want him to be accomplished, want him to feel good about himself, so we'd give him 8. He'd do 6. We all look at each other, scratch our heads, I don't understand this. All right, let's give him 6. Maybe he'll finish. You do 4 or 3. Eventually, because his capacity level could only see himself doing less than what he could possibly do, he eventually just went off doing something else. And he was gone. And when he left, I was particularly disappointed. Because a lot of times what we do in business is we hire people for capacity when they don't have the capacity. Someone's going somewhere and they're only going to here. We follow people in the ministry that instead of going somewhere into the promised land, they're only going down here just to get the church established and sing a few songs on Sunday and, you know, pay their bills. Come on. I'm telling you the truth. And then may I take you as an example, Mignon? I hope not to embarrass you, but you're my friend. And when Mignon, how many years have been since you've come? Going into about 24 years, she's been with us on staff. She was working for a local newspaper guy who occasionally came to our church. But she was such an aggressive worker that we had to offer her a job, and we did. Offered her a job 24 some odd years ago, 23 years ago. She took the job. Opposite of that other employee, she was like a worker of all workers. The guy calls me on the phone that she used to work for, and he's as mad as a wet hen, and he chews me out for hiring his best person. He says, you know, she's the best person that's ever worked for me. And he made this comment that really ticked me off. She's like a mule. The more you put on her, the more she'll work. I said, oh. Well, she'll be treated differently in this place. He said, what do you mean? I said, she'll have respect and she'll never be thought of as a mule. And she has worked for us all of these years completely different because her capacity level was great, but she saw different things than the first guy employee who couldn't quite make it. Why? It wasn't that they didn't have faith. It wasn't that he didn't have faith. He had lots of faith when you listen to him. He didn't have capacity. And the difference is whether or not you can hold on to what it is that you're being filled with. Are you being filled with God? Or are you being filled with the world? Even people that are filled with the world take their capacity levels to do great things. How much more can we, the church, do? And we don't even have a concept of it. Proverbs, the 27th chapter, and I'll make this statement to you, and wrong thinking can stop our capacity. In Proverbs 27, it says these words, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And that's the part of the verse I want you to see. And all of a sudden, when you start saying to yourself, I can't go there. I don't know how to do that. I'm not going to be able to manage that. That's not me. That you have just solidified the level of your capacity. Because it's never been about you since you got saved. Is that not true? It's always been about the one who determines and builds and encourages the promised land with capacity. But we fail to trust him because we're so filled with the stuff of the world. The news media, the politics. And I'm not saying don't watch that stuff. Don't let it fill you. Don't let it stop you from having the proper evaluation. So here's a question for tonight, and we'll finish with this in just a few minutes. How can I change my capacity level? And the number one thing I could say to all of us in here to change our capacity level so that we could be what God would have us to be instead of being what we think we ought to be, are satisfied with where we're really at. Because what you're doing is you want to just achieve, here's your goal, to achieve more than what you had your parents achieve. And God wants to take you a whole lot further than the wilderness, wants to take you into the promised land. So how can I change my capacity? Number one, you got to realize that God wants you to change. So therefore, here's the answer. Ask God to help. The Bible makes it very clear that you have not because you ask not. And there's very few of you in this room that have ever asked God to change your capacity level. You've asked God for this. You've asked God for money. You've asked God for a better job. You've asked God for all kinds of. But have you ever said that, God, I want a better job? God says, I can't give it to you because you won't understand the capacity level. Just recently, I heard about somebody who won millions and tens of millions of dollars in the lottery. Went to a church as a Christian guy, you know, was a tither, according to his pastor. Got crazy, could not handle the money. Now I understand that they're in divorce, and drugs are involved, and family's failing, the whole thing, and they had it all. So God, give me a better job. God gives you a better job, you can't handle it. And because of the better job, you walk away from God thinking you're all that. Can I tell you something? Your capacity level is skewed. And you won't get anywhere. And a lot of times that happens. And that's why God is developing the heart on the inside of every one of us so that our capacity levels can change. But it really starts with God. I realize I can only go so far by myself. I really need you to help me, God, because I can't do this by myself. And you have not because you ask not. But I love this verse found in 1 John the 5th chapter. Just pop it up on the overhead for me. Verse 14, I think it is. Now, this is a confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, according to his will, according to his will, I'm not talking about asking stupid stuff. I'm talking about asking according to his will, right? You know, go ahead and talk about anything you want to talk about. Call me any names you want to talk about. I'm not talking about foolishly asking God for stupid things. I'm asking God, change my capacity so I could be what you would have me to be and go where you have me to go and do what you'd have me to do. I want to enter into the promised land to be a witness to a lost and dying world. I want you to use me in a greater way than I can even think of. Can I tell you something? It is the will of God from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. Therefore, he says, well, according to my will, listen to this, he hears us. I love that. Thank God you hear us, God. Thank God for the next verse. I don't want him just to hear me. Here's the answer to that, verse 15. And he says, and I know that if he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petition that we have asked of him. You know, sometimes you have to just stay and say, God, I need you to evaluate where I'm at. Would you just be honest with me, Lord? Of course you would be. It's impossible for him to be dishonest. But oftentimes he'll be quiet. Isn't that interesting? Lord, speak to me about where I'm at with capacity. Am I living in a place far and thinking of things far and doing things far and saying things far and having less than I should be. Where do you want me to be? Where is my capacity level built by you? Because without it, my friends, we're not going to make it. Second thing I would suggest, and how we can change our capacity levels, is this. You've got to understand that pressure changes capacity. I hate this. It's true, though. You ever seen a balloon? The pressure from the outside changes the capacity of that balloon. Because it's got pressure on the outside, keeps it small. As soon as the pressure comes from the inside, the balloon expands and changes its, if you will, capacity level. Pressure in life is designed not to hurt you or to hinder you or to cause you to stay small-minded, but it is actually there to refine you to a larger capacity level. It's actually a good thing. Let me say it like this. If there was no satanic activity in our life, we would all smile and be happy, but we'd be the lousiest Christians there ever was. You know it, and so do I. Very important. Pressure changes our capacity. Recently, I went to the doctor. I had little, you know, when you get old, you get these weird things growing on your body. Older people laugh, and the younger people say, ew. So everybody's younger say, ew. Oh, shut up. And then, so, you know, you get this, so you go to the doctor, and I've got this surgery coming on, you know, and I had a little surgery on my back. They say, oh, let's see what that is. And all of a sudden, you know, I'm petrified because they're going to shoot me with needles, and they're going to, after it's numb, they're going to cut it off and take it and send it out. And I don't give a flip about cancer. I just go to Jesus. I mean, you're going to have a hard time even doing anything except wanting to go to Jesus, you know? So I don't have a problem with that. I'm not afraid of death or any of that. So that doesn't bother me. I hate the needle and I hate the knife. You know what I'm talking about? And so the first time I went there, I went, whew, I'm so happy to get out of this place. Wow, it's great. Now somebody in the party said, okay, this is fine, that's fine, this we ought to take off. So they took it off. And but the second time I went, there's about 30 stitches there. And the second time I went, I covered this up so you wouldn't see it. The second time I went, I was at total peace because I understood what I experienced the first time. The pressure of the first time helped me for capacity level for the second time. Are you following me? And the pressure that you go through day in and day out is really not there to stop you, but to build your capacity level so you can believe God for greater things. Are you following me? A lot of times we don't see that, but the scripture tells us in 1 Peter, just pop it up in the first chapter, 1 Peter, verse number 6. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, I love the, thank God for the little while. If you're going through times of pressure, trial, it's a little while. It's coming to a close. You just hang in there. Is that okay? For a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. Has anybody ever been there? I mean, come on, if anybody ever been a Christian, you know you've been there. Come on, you're just lazy and your capacity level is I do not want to raise my hand right now. So let's change our capacity level. How many people know that that's exactly right? Yeah, okay, it's better. Some of you raised two hands. Verse 7 comes along and says this. He says, that the genuineness of your faith being much more precious than the gold, genuineness of your faith is faith after and has the ability to have a capacity level to hold what it is you're believing God for. That the genuineness of your faith being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is a test by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. In other words, can I tell you something? Pressure is designed to change your capacity level, not to deflate you, but to increase you. Wow. Some of you got some great things ahead of you because you have a lot of pressure in your life. The third thing I want to say to you on how you can change your capacity, I'm going to give you 30, but I just picked three, is that you've got to recognize the source of capacity, and it's Jesus and grace. God's sovereign, divine. God's sovereign, what's the word after this? God's sovereign, divine ability. Wait a minute. God's sovereign, that's his, he can do whatever he wants. Divine, it's God. What's the next word? Ability. To do what you can't do. Oh my goodness. Jesus is the source of my new capacity level. Not me, what I think, not my checkbook, not whether or not I have the money in the bank or don't have the money in the bank. That has nothing to, whether I have security or don't have security, has nothing to do with it. Whether or not I have Jesus, that now has something to do with it. Someone asked me the other day, how do you plan on doing it? I said, I have absolutely no idea. Do you even know what you're doing? No, but Jesus, he knows and he'll make a way. Is that not true? Jeez. In other words, when I take all the, can I just swear? I'm Jim. Can I just say it like it is? Get the picture of this. When I take all the crap of my life, crap of your life, and I submerge my capacity level back into him, all of a sudden, I'm just surrounded by his goodness. It is fulfillment. And my capacity level, because God wants your faith, and he's got it for most of you, but he doesn't have your capacity level. When we started this church, I didn't have any capacity level at all. I didn't even want the church to make it. My capacity level was my business. But then we got... had about a couple of thousand people in church, and we needed to move out of our building. You know, we rented 45,000 square feet of industrial building in Loma Linda. Anybody remember the Rock Church? I think it was called the Rock Christian Center then, right? And so God said, you need to get your own building. I said to Debbie, I said, let's get our own building. She said, well, how can we do that? And I said, I don't know, but I don't have any money. But maybe we can raise some money and do it. We could probably build a $5 million building somewhere, or buy a $5 million building. Let's start looking, which we did. You remember that, Mignon? Yep. And I was looking at five, maybe $6 million. Over here in Colton, there was an abandoned Target store, and they wanted $5 million. I was about ready to buy that. And I thought that'd be cool. You know, it was 100,000 square feet. By the way, there's about 200,000 square feet under roof here. So thank God we didn't buy that. And so I went to a builder, and we found this piece of property. I didn't like the piece of property because it was too small. But that was my ego. And it was too small, but it fit our budget. So we bought this piece of property. It was 22 acres of land. And we had rights to buy property around us, too, and which we did. And I went to the builder. I sat with the builder, and we gave him the plans and said, "Can you give us a rough idea? I mean, we're on the edge of our seat. We can handle 5-6 million. I'm thinking, oh, I know I could push 7, maybe 8 million. That's where my capacity level was. And I said, you know, where are we? And he did the numbers. It was between 11 and 12 million. I sat back, I'll never forget it, in his office, and I said, oh my gosh, we don't have that kind of money. I don't know where we would get that. I can't even imagine coming up with that kind of money. But I knew that God wanted it. My capacity level was not my checkbook. It went from there, was it, Deb? It wasn't our savings. We couldn't look at that. Fred Adams, our administrator, did a survey. He gave us he took all the toilets in a building and figured out how much cost just for toilet paper. And it was $10,000 a month for toilet paper and hand towels. And I about killed him because it just ruined, it was the Coke in my capacity level, you know? And I about killed him because I want to hear that, Fred. I want to hear that, Fred. And he says, oh, cool, I got it worked out. If we can make every woman in there only take two little sheets, that ain't not going to happen, you know? What am I supposed to do, tell them, stand there and watch them? That ain't going to happen, man. And so $10,000, you know, so it couldn't be based on money, which isn't that funny? Because everything you do is based on what you can do instead of what God can do. Everything. You don't buy the car because it's not based on what God wants. You based on what you can afford, what you have the ability to do, what your capacity is. You don't buy that new truck because your capacity level is down there. You fight over money all the time, husband and wife, because your capacity levels are different. And so we ended up just keeping our eyes on God. Every time we came to a meeting as we were building this place, there was an extra 150, extra 200, extra 500,000. Guys, we built this building for $18.5 million. And since then, we've put in another $5 million or so in improvements. And we have somewhere in the neighborhood of about $23 million. And now it's worth $45 million. And we only owe a little over $7 million, which we're going to pay off. But we can't do that unless you have a capacity level for that. And that's the whole point. Businesses only go so far and stop because that's where their capacity level is. I was eating in a restaurant not too long ago, and I said to myself, oh, my goodness. They ought to franchise this. It's the best thing going. Owner says, no way, I don't want any problems. I'm fine just where I'm at. Capacity level. Had a great thing going, capacity level. And oftentimes our capacity level is right there where we think because we've been trained by the world, our parents, instead of seeing things through the eyes of our Lord and Savior. Jesus Christ. He had a bigger picture for the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, and he still does for the future. It's bigger now than it'll ever be as we grow in the future. There's a bigger vision and there's greater leadership coming than Deborah and I are here already. But that's a vision of capacity. So change in your capacity. Why not ask God? Realize that every problem you have in pressure is good. It helps build you to where God wants you to be so that you can have a bigger capacity. And thirdly, realize your capacity level is not your wallet, checkbook, job. I love this, education. Whether Democrats or Republicans are in office, have you noticed they're both idiots? Have you noticed that? Doesn't matter who's in office, they screw everything up. Our faith and our capacity is determined by the King of Glory. His name has got to be Jesus Christ. Come on, somebody. Let's talk about this. If you were to die in the next few minutes, what makes you think you're going to go to heaven? Is that a good question? Because if you die in the next few minutes, you're either going to heaven or you're going to hell. Nobody wants to, in their right mind, go to hell. I'm sure there are some crazy people out there that think it's cool, but when they get there, it ain't going to be cool at all. You don't want to go to hell. Now let's stop and think about it. You cannot get to heaven your way. You got to get to heaven Jesus's way. Jesus said, I'm the way. This is what Jesus said. Truth and life. No man goes to the Father. Watch this. Here's what Jesus said. Except by me. You can't make it any other way but his way. Now, he's either a liar, crazy, nuts as can be, or he's telling the truth. And the bottom line is if you check scripture and thousands of years of prophetic utterances, it's absolutely 100% true. Proved itself over and over and over. You can't get there any other way. So he comes and he dies on the cross for you to get to heaven. And you're going to have to get to heaven, but his way, not your way. It's very important that you know that. Some people say, I'm going to get to heaven because I'm really a good person. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you get to go to heaven because you're good? You're not going to make it. Somebody needs to tell you that. Some of you say to yourself, well, I'm going to go to heaven because my mom and dad told me I was a Christian when I was a kid. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that your mom and dad could tell you you're a Christian, makes you a Christian. It's not in the Bible. You're not going to make it. Some of you say, well, I hope I get to heaven. You know, I'm really going to be a nice person. I hope I get there. Guess what? You might, you know, get to Disneyland because you're nice, but you're not going to get to heaven because you're nice. That's not how you get to heaven. Some of you might say, wait a minute, I sang in the choir at my last church. I helped out. I carried out pastor's Bible. I counted the offering. I was a church leader. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible says that'll get you to heaven. Isn't that interesting? The only way to get to heaven is Jesus' way, and he makes a statement. It's very clear. Here's how to do it. You must be born again. Some of you probably say to yourself, wait a minute, I think I'm going to go to heaven. I think no positive thinkers are going to make it. That's not how you get to heaven. You must be born, must be born. You must be born again. What in the heck does that mean? Let me tell you, from the beginning of the Bible, the end of the Bible, here's what it means. Are you ready? It means you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Always has been, always will be. God forgive us. In American churches, we've watered that down so we don't want to put pressure on people so they'll come into church, give their attendance, give their money, and we'll feel good about ourselves. God forgive us. In American churches, it's always been an all or nothing relationship from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, all or nothing. And you're going to have to do something. You're going to have to give God all of your heart. You're going to have to do something, give God all of your life. And if you can't do that, you're not going to make it because you're too into yourself to give him all of your heart and give him all of your life. And God's not looking for nice people or good people or not looking for people that go to church or quote scripture. God's looking for somebody that will give them all of their heart and all their life, have that kind of a relationship with Jesus. The Bible says the book of Revelation, you've heard of the book of Revelation, it's the last book in the Bible, you know you heard of it. Jesus said, I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot or better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Oh my goodness, what a rude, crude statement. We've all got this visual of Jesus. He's so kind, he's so sweet, he's so nice, he would never say anything disturbing or frustrating to any of us. But can I tell you something? Here's Jesus, blunt, bold, and in your face. I'll vomit you from my mouth if you're lukewarm. What's lukewarm? Let me define it for you. Little in, little out, little up, little down. Token prayer, occasional church attendance. You're not against God, but watch this. You're not wholehearted for God. That's lukewarm. And you're not going to make it. And someone needs to love you, respect you, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. And I love you and respect you and honor you enough. I'm just too old to play games with people. I just want to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. And you have to do something in order to get to heaven. You're going to have to give God all of your heart. You're going to have to give God all of your life. All means all. He's not going to steal it from you because he's not a thief. He's not a conniver to talk you out of it. He's not a manipulator to make you give him all of your heart and all of your life. Just do that. You're not going to float around some cosmic cloud with a 2x4 and hitch in the head until you'd finally do this. No. He gives you a free will choice to make the choice. I choose. That's what he wants. Give you all my heart and give you all my life, Jesus. And that's what born again really means from the beginning of the Bible, the end of the Bible. And from there, then God leads you into your own personal promised land by learning how to do things his way. And that's why this Bible is so thick and full of wonderful insights on how to live life. Today, here we are in this safe, friendly place. You were great listening to the Word of God. Thank you so much for that. We've worshiped, we've clapped our hands, we've sung songs. But it would be a tragedy for you to walk out of here the same as you walked in. And tonight you have a divine appointment. Just like I had a doctor's appointment or a dental appointment or a painter's appointment or a plumber's appointment. Guess what? Tonight you have an appointment with Jesus Christ to give him all of your heart, give him all of your life. God brought you here. Tonight is your night of salvation. I'm speaking that over you. And I'm believing God that you're smart enough to understand that it's your day and your time to get right with God. And God brought you here for this reason. And all across this auditorium, you might say to me, Pastor Jim, how do I get right with God? Well, you get right with God, God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this. It'll sound like this. One, two, three, bang. When you hear that sound, bang, your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is, I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. Be born again, headed for heaven, and denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. You can put it right back down. You say, wait a minute, Pastor. Hold on. Stop, Pastor. Are you kidding me, raising my hand publicly in heaven? I mean, in this church? That would embarrass me like crazy to raise my hand. Yep, it will. It's better that you be embarrassed in a safe place like this, where people love you and want you to do it, than to go to hell because you care more about what people think instead of what God sees tonight. Tonight is your night of salvation. You may think you're a Christian, but you can't think your way into heaven. You need to make sure, and if you've never given him all of your heart, given him all of your life, I'm speaking to you right now. Get ready to put your hand up. So who should raise your hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Get ready to put your hand up. If you've never given him all of your heart, and you know if you have or haven't, maybe you just had him in your head. You celebrate Christmas and Easter every year of your life. But did you know that won't get you to heaven? The devil knows who Jesus is, and he's not going to heaven. He's got head knowledge about Jesus, and he's not going to heaven. Listen to me. Tonight, it's not about what's in your head. It's about your heart. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're not sure, make sure. If you've never given him all of your life, tonight is your night to give him all of your life. Make the turn. Let's go for God. Get his capacity for the rest of your life instead of staying in your own. Tonight is your night of salvation. I'm going to count three. I've done my job tonight. I'm going to count to three and I'm pop my hands together. My goodness sakes alive. Why wouldn't every one of you that are not right with God want to get your hand up? Don't let the devil talk you out of it right now. You know you need this. And if you're embarrassed, who cares? You're going for God and God's going to be excited about it. Are you ready? Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands all across this auditorium. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. God bless you for your courage. There's one. But I know there's more than one. Boy, tonight, today, it's been tough. Pastor Dan was pulling teeth this morning. Well, there's another one. Where are you? Wave at me if there's another one here. Oh, I got you. Okay, good for you. Good for you. Glory to God. There's two tough people in here. Anybody else? Two tough, wise people. Anybody else that you know you need to get your hand up all across? There's two tough, wise people. Listen, one of the things, the first thing that's mentioned in the book of Revelation is the people who don't make it are cowards. Did you know that? I would have thought he would have said sinners or, you know, weirdos or perverts or screwed up people or murderers, but he doesn't. He says, cowards are the first one because it takes courage to get right with God. Anybody else? Anybody else? There's two people with courage in this place tonight. Anybody else? Want to give your heart and life to Jesus? Don't even mess with me. It's just time to get your hand up. Let's go. Come on. Come on. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? All right. Well, praise God for two wise people. All right. Here's what we're going to do. You guys with courage, get a hold of your coat, purse, water, Bible, friend. Is that okay? I want you to get your stuff. Two of you with courage. And there's about a dozen more of you, but I'll take five that ought to have raised your hand, but you didn't. And I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, water, Bible, friend. Nudge your neighbor and say, come on, I'll go if you'll go. Get out of your seat. Get in the aisle. Meet me right here in front. At least those two that raised your hand, you're serious about God, I want you to come. And anybody that should have raised your hand but didn't and you know you should have, you get up here too. Come on. The rest of us, let's stand and welcome them as they come. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, if you're serious about God, you come right now. Come on. Every breath that I I said 2 plus 5. He didn't count, he's security. Isn't that cool? How about before we clap and shout and think Pastor Jim's wonderful, how about if I tell you, I'll just keep you for a moment more. There's 3 more of you need to get a hold of your stuff and come right now, and you know it. I don't know where you're at, so I'm not staring at you to make you feel uncomfortable. But God spoke to me just this moment and said, give them a few moments more. I love them so much, I want them to come. I'm not trying to put the pressure on you, but God is right now. And you know you need to come, hurry, because I can't keep the people. If that's you, just do and be obedient. Be obedient and you come. You come. There's 3 more of you. There's 3 more of you. Well, listen, all of you in front, thank God you've come. This is my friend, Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. No weird stuff goes on. I promise you. You know how you go to church, you think maybe they're weird, going to roll down the aisle and all that kind of stuff and bring out the snakes and all that. Well, that's only when Pastor Dan preaches, you know. I'm kidding. I'm just kidding. Well, just teasing. But listen quickly. He's going to pray with you, give you some free information about what to do next, because that's important. You know, read it. It's simple. And he's going to help you. He's going to introduce you to a friend called Spiritual Personal Trainer that'll meet you before church service. And if you'll give God, just keep on, let us help you go on with God. I'm telling you, your life will never be the same. You'll be blessed and blessed and blessed and blessed. And I promise you, you're going to do great, mighty, marvelous things far beyond that what you ever thought of or dreamt of. So make a left turn. The 3 of you that need to come right now, hurry, make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right over that way. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you. Bye-bye.